Hello and welcome to this webinar on managing the risk of redback spiders in broccoli crops. So this was a project which was funded by Hort Innovation with the Vegetable Levy and was actually completed just over a year ago. But at this time of year, this is peak potential spider time. So we thought it was worth going over this material again. So my name is Jenny Ekman. I work for a company called Applied Horticultural Research, and this is one of the, I think, the most interesting projects that I've ever done. So the issue is, uh-oh. So the issue is that since 2016, there have been numerous consumer complaints about redback spiders in broccoli, only since 2016, which is kind of interesting too. So this is how it usually comes, is that somebody finds a spider in their broccoli, and the first thing they want to do is tell everyone about it. So they might go to a paper, they might go to Facebook, they tell all their friends, and this is really not very good publicity for broccoli, which is, a healthy, nutritious crop. We don't want to be turning people off eating broccoli. So this is an example from 2019. Fiona Scott, wife of a football player, has urged people to be careful after she found a redback spider lurking in broccoli that she purchased at Coles. Mr. Scott said if his wife hadn't found the deadly arachnid hiding in the vegetable, it could have bitten one of his children. So I'm really pleased that they're encouraging their children to go foraging around in the vegetable drawer in the fridge for snacks. That's really great. But, well, we'll see how big an issue this is. And for the sake of balance, here's one from Woolworths. Again, on Facebook, finding a redback spider in their broccoli, and yes, presumably wanting some sort of compensation. So, when does this happen? All right, it's about now. Most detections are at the end of summer when spider populations are at their maximum. We can see that most of the detections are in Queensland and New South Wales. However, really, this is happening all over Australia. Including Western Australia. I think redbacks have been found in all regions. They don't respect boundaries. So we don't know where the broccoli came from in each of these instances because it's not readily traceable after someone's bought it and taken it home. But we do know where it was sold. So that's all we can report. So we don't know the source of this issue. So what about spiders? What the hell are they doing in broccoli? So I thought I'd run through some of the interesting things about the lifespan of redback spiders and how they develop and why they might end up in a head of broccoli. So spiders, of course, are an arachnid, not an insect. But like insects, they're not warm-blooded. So how quickly they develop, how active they are, totally depends on temperature. So the development is going to be fastest when it's hot and dry. So 25 to 35 degrees is really the sweet spot for redback spiders. They prefer it to be dry as well. I mean, if it's wet, then they're not happy at all. If the temperatures are lower than that, then the females can take up to 3 months to mature, whereas it's about 2 months at under the conditions that they prefer. If it falls below 10 degrees, then they basically stop developing. They could survive, but they stop developing. The other thing is that there are extreme differences between the sexes. So if you've seen a redback spider, chances are it was a girl because the females are these ones that we're familiar with the beautiful red hourglass on their abdomen. And they can be 50 times or even 100 times bigger than the tiny male who is here. So this little male, he's just a sort of brown and white spider. You wouldn't even necessarily know he was a redback spider. He's just a tiny little creature. So females can live a year. Males are lucky to make it to 4 months, maybe 6 months at the outside. They're a much shorter-lived creature. Males, they will give a painful bite, but they're generally regarded as sort of semi-venomous. I mean, the bite's painful, but it's nothing like the bite that a female can do. So, but most of the time, you wouldn't even notice them. So the male's whole purpose in life, his special purpose is, of course, to mate. So how are they going to find each other? All right, so females do produce pheromones and they spread them over their webs. And these are what attract the males. So I have heard some growers think that females are like spiders are attracting other spiders into a crop by producing pheromones, but they're not. They're only attracting the male spiders, which you probably wouldn't even notice. So once a male has found a female, he does something which is really unique to redback spiders, in that they actually encourage the female to cannibalize them while they're mating. So this is some extracts from a video taken by the University of Toronto. So here's our female spider being courted by a little tiny male. So if he starts off by kind of twinging at her web, just bouncing on it a bit. So initially this was thought to be so that she wouldn't eat him, but actually he's so small that the females couldn't even be bothered to eat him. So he's really not prey. So this is more actually saying like, I'm here. I'd like to mate with you, so that she, you know, can pay attention basically. So once he's got her attention, he will come and he actually carries his sperm on palps, which are the little appendages which are in front of the legs. And so he'll put sperm on one of his palps and he'll creep up underneath her on her tummy, and then he'll put in the palp and start transferring the sperm. And that's what we can see in this picture here. Here's the male spider here. In order to keep her entertained while he's doing this, he does a very unique thing. He actually somersaults and he puts his abdomen against her fangs, whereupon she spits digestive juices on him and starts to have a bit of a gnaw. So now the timing is critical because he has to get his second palp away if he's going to father all of her babies. And so after about 10 minutes, so here she is, she's turned him, he's upside down, he's got his abdomen against her fangs, and she's having a bit of a start of a gnaw. But then here he's broken away. So he breaks away, he has a little rest for maybe 10 minutes, maybe half an hour, just gathers himself, and then he goes back for the final one, sticks in the second set of palp, and that's when she just eats him. And his life is over, but his purpose is done. And that is something unique to redback spiders. And I can see every male slightly cringing as you're talking about that. So once they've mated, the female spiders lay 3 to 8 egg sacs on average, but they can lay up to 6 sacs. Each egg sac has about 150 eggs. Now, importantly, the egg sacs are protected by waterproof silk. So that means that pesticides are not going to penetrate inside to where the baby spiderlings are. So they hatch inside that egg sac, and then about a week later, about 75% of them will emerge as baby spiderlings. So this means that every female spider can produce up to maybe 700 babies. So you can see just how quickly you can go from one spider to a major outbreak, because, you know, in summer, under the right conditions, they're really going to multiply quickly. So once the spiderlings have emerged, they need to find their own place. And most spiders will do this by ballooning. So that's when, as you can see at the picture at right here, they produce a long strand of silk from their abdomen, which catches the wind, and then they can drift on the wind currents for meters, kilometers even, several kilometers, and that's how they distribute themselves. There is really no evidence that redbacks do this. redbacks, in fact, just walk. And as a result, the populations don't spread very far every year. So most of the time, it's less than 300 metres. Most of the time, it's less than 100 metres. And we know this because we have successfully introduced redbacks to Japan, New Zealand, Belgium, and a number of other countries. So in Japan, they've done a lot of work trying to understand how to manage them, how to control them, prevent them spreading. And so that was why they have come up with these equations, which really show that they don't spread very far. And if there's an unsuitable habitat, like an open field or a river, then they don't disperse across that barrier. In other words, for a redback to find a new home, they need human help. And that's where they're great little hitchhikers. They go on equipment, they can go on vehicles, they can hide out in shipping containers, hence why we've introduced them to so many countries in the world. But really, they're relying on humans. So we think that redback spiders originated in South Australia. There's not really a lot of records from the Aboriginals. They weren't terribly familiar with them. And this has given rise to the theory that redbacks have only multiplied since Europeans came along and provided them with suitable habitat and ways of spreading. So, of course, redbacks are famous for hanging out in the outback dunnies, and this is perfect for them because redbacks, they're a timid little spider. They just want the quiet life. They want to live in somewhere that's well sheltered, protected from the sun, the wind, the rain. They really prefer human habitats over the natural environment. They prefer it over croplands, definitely. They'll shelter inside, you know, wasteland areas. They'll tend to hang out inside rabbit holes, perhaps. They can sometimes be found also in pumpkin fields. So underneath a pumpkin, that's a pretty nice dry place, especially if they're growing on plastic. Melons, table grapes, where they can climb up inside the canopy underneath that cover, beautiful warm dry spot for them. Cotton and other densely foliaged crops, so lettuce definitely. Other things like kale and even Asian leafy vegetables are a potential habitat for them, anywhere that it's going to be warm and dry. So there's one in the lettuce, which we found. We were growing a crop of lettuce and we found several redbacks. That's a young female redback, and she's quite happily there underneath a cos lettuce. So despite their timid personality, they are real survivors. So they can survive for below zero. There are records of them surviving from minus 10 degrees. They can stay active into the 40 degrees, they can survive 46 degrees, no problem. They can live for 4 months without food and they don't even need water. So they're pretty tough. A few years ago, I did a little project looking at whether they would be killed by irradiation, similar to we use irradiation to as a quarantine treatment against fruit flies. And the answer was basically nah. They will just laugh at you. So 500 grays, which is 100 times what is would kill a person, and you're still only killing 50%. They're really tough. Redbacks will inherit the earth. So we can spot them. Now, it's a useful thing to know what their webs look like because they are quite distinctive. So here we have the retreat, where the spider will hang out during the day because they're generally nocturnal. They don't like to be out. So they build this little retreat surrounded by webbing. And then they have underneath here this tangle web and finally some trap lines. And the trap lines have got little droplets of sticky stuff on them. So as a millipede or a beetle comes along the ground, it'll snag that and they can feel the line pull and then they can run down and they can throw a bit of webbing around it and then inject it with venom and then suck its body dry. They tend to leave their prey in the webs. They're a very untidy spider, and that is one of the key characteristics. Most spiders like a clean web. Redbacks, they don't care. They're not good housekeepers. Their webs are also very strong. So you can see the difference between that and something like a house spider web or a web of a daddy long legs. So daddy long legs will actually kill and eat redbacks. And that may be why there's this urban myth that daddy long legs are super venomous, but their fangs can't pierce human skin. Like, they can pierce human skin, but they're not very venomous, but certainly they will attack and eat redbacks. So maybe that's why we thought, wow, that's one hell of a spider taking on a redback. So here's some pictures of redback webs. You can see in this one, like, look, there's bits of millipede, there's bits of beetle, all sorts of stuff that's just been left there. And this really shows us the structure of the web. This is inside an electrical box. This is its little retreat up here. You can see a few egg sacs hanging around. There's four there, bit of a tangle web here and here. And then finally, there's the trap lines with the sticky fluid just waiting for a little beetle to walk past and snag it. These are not redback webs. So these are more house spiders. This is the culprit here. They just messy looking, tangly sort of a web. So it's good to know the difference. So if you see these, don't panic, it's not redbacks. So the preferred prey. So what they really like are ground dwelling beetles. That's the best thing. But millipedes, flies, cockroaches, crickets, slaters, other spiders, all sorts of things, you know, they'll even take on a small snake, and there are pictures on the web of them eating mice. So once they get their venom in, they can really pack a punch. Now, of course, most of these prey are not pest species. So if, as a grower, you're using IPM, they are unlikely to be controlled, particularly for something like pumpkins. I mean, who cares if there's a few beetles walking around? So that is the conditions which favour redback spiders. And, you know, environments like warm, dry conditions are good for beetles, good for spiders. They go together. So risk factors. Okay, though, as I mentioned before, reports have come from all states and regions. Nowhere is immune to this. However, most of the finds were in 2016. And most of the pictures seem to be young female spiders. So this is a really immature female, semi-mature, and this one sort of about to be a young mum, perhaps. So those finds are consistent with the egg sacs having been laid in about midsummer, and we've got that 2-month period for them to mature. 2016 was a nice warm summer, drier than average. And the other thing was that prices for pumpkins were really low. I suspect that maybe some crops were abandoned, and that would certainly allow the spider populations to persist and multiply. So that may have been a factor. Of course, since then, growers have been a lot, you know, conscious of this as an issue. Like, up until then, nobody who knew. But since then, I think we're a lot more aware of it, and so pickers, packers are looking for spiders and, you know, aware of this issue. Warm, dry conditions are what they like. So this graph shows the average conditions in another Broccoli area, Werribee. You can see the minimum to maximum temperatures during the year. For comparison, here's Gatton. You could see it's about nearly 10 degrees warmer during summer, and that is really what redback spiders like. So the development will be much faster in somewhere like Gatton than in Werribee. As we said, redbacks are mostly moved by humans. So if there are redbacks in Broccoli, well, they've probably been carried in on equipment. So this may be irrigation pipes, seedling trays, machinery, harvest bins. There could also be cross-contamination between crops. So if a harvest bin has been sitting undisturbed with pumpkins in it and there were redbacks on the pumpkins, then they might find little harborages. All those little sections inside plastic bins could make quite a nice home for a spider, and so that would provide them with, you know, harborage basically. So where do they come from? And this is theory one, is that spiders are living in the crop and they just hang on after harvest. So this is consistent with the observation that newly hatched spiderlings can grow into mature females in that, you know, up to 2 months, 25 degrees. So perhaps when we're planting broccoli, the eggs or spiderlings have dropped off the machinery, or they've survived from the previous crop like pumpkins, and then they've grown up in the crop. If there's a lot of non-pest insects like beetles, then they provide food for the spiders. And I mean, this is supported by the fact that we know spiders are found in other field crops like cotton, lettuce, leafy greens generally, and pumpkins. Theory two is that the spiders invade the harvested product post-harvest. So this is where plastic harvest bins, hiding places for spiders, they might have been storing pumpkins. You put the broccoli in and then they go into the cold room, and then the spiders think, oh, it's a bit chilly. Maybe I'll just climb up into this nice warm broccoli and hide there. And then they chill down and they become completely dormant. This is supported by the fact most consumer pictures don't seem to have any webbing in them. So you think, well, okay, the spider may have moved, but why aren't we seeing any webbing? The exception to that is this one here, which we can see a little bit of webbing. So that does suggest, in that case, the spider may have been living in that broccoli beforehand. So we don't really know. It's probably a bit of both, really. Now, what are we going to do about it? This is all very well, but we need to solve this problem. So number one, field hygiene. If you knew that redbacks were in the previous crop, like pumpkins, then simply ploughing in the residues is a great way of controlling them. So there was a study in New Zealand, they were trying to eradicate them from this area. They found that there were huge populations hiding inside the rabbit holes. They basically went and collapsed the rabbit holes, got rid of the rabbits, and 6 months later, all the spiders are gone. So they cannot survive in an open ploughed field where there's no habitat for them. If you eliminate harborages, so that's like piles of old equipment, pipes and things, places where they can live from around the outside of the crop, then that will also prevent them from coming in. I might also mention that there's a new organic pyrethroid insecticide called Pyganic by Sumitomo, and that is registered for use against spiders in vegetable crops. However, certainly you cannot use just a broad spectrum pesticide against redbacks, because they're not registered. And moreover, you know, there's issues with how you apply a pesticide. I mean, if they're living right inside a broccoli head, then how's it going to get at it? And so I've just said, well, it's kind of like using a steamroller to juice a lemon. It's not very efficient and it may be ineffective. Nonetheless, there is now a chemical which is registered for that use, and it can be applied if there's a problem. The other thing is that all equipment should be cleaned before using, and that is where you can use a general broad spectrum pesticide. So something like bifenthrin, chlorpyrifos, alpha cypermethrin are all active against spiders and they are registered for controlling them on equipment. But in this case, you must be very careful about cross-contamination. So if they're on a plastic bin, then make sure that doesn't then contaminate the crop and, you know, breach an MRL. Remember that if they're just formulated in water, they're not going to be effective against the egg sacs because they're waterproof. Another suggestion has been chlorine, and chlorine can certainly dissolve webbing, but it does not kill spiders. One thing we tried during this project, just as a really small thing, we got a few spiders and we simply sprayed them with detergent, and it was amazingly effective. We think this is because spiders, they don't have lungs. They just have spiracles, like little holes that allow oxygen to come into the body. They have a waxy cuticle on the outside. If we spray them with a detergent or a surfactant, then that disrupts that cuticle and it probably blocks the hole and they basically suffocate. So that is an effective way of killing them. It was amazingly so. So this one is a wetting agent, one is just a simple detergent. But in the end, simply washing down equipment may be enough to get rid of them. So that's hygiene is really the first line of defense. So now if we just think about the potential risks, if a spider gets through, if a spider's living in the crop, what could happen? The most risky thing is that a worker gets bitten by one during harvest or packing. But workers are usually using gloves, they're using boots, and there's no way that a spider's going to be able to bite through those. So that is a risk mitigation. Of course, we've had a few finds of broccoli at retail or found by customers. So while the likelihood of this is very low, it rarely happens, and even more rarely now than previously, now that we're aware of this issue. But the impacts are quite severe. So product withdrawal, loss of reputation, loss of sales, people don't want to eat broccoli, they put it on Facebook. With that, even more severe would be if a spider actually bit a customer. So what's the likelihood of a redback spider biting a customer when they're taking broccoli out of the fridge? It's very low, because remember, they're inactive at below 10 degrees. So a fridge is about 4. It can't bite anyone. It's got to warm up first. Only once it warms up will it be able to walk around and maybe bite somebody. Or they could bite them during preparation. So what happens if you're bitten by a redback spider? What happens? So there's a lot of stuff like, these are deadly spider. Nobody has died from a redback spider bite since 1955. Now, I'm not saying the bites aren't extremely unpleasant. I've read some accounts of this and it's quite nasty. People may not realize they've been bitten for some time, like half an hour, and then it can be quite severe. There is an antivenin which may or may not be helpful, but certainly in these modern times, we have very good pain relief, and that's really the main risk is from just severe pain and shock. So it's unpleasant, but that's the risk. And finally, we thought, well, what happened if you actually ate a redback spider by accident? Okay, very, very unlikely. But the good news is that the venom would be destroyed by the low pH in the stomach, and it would certainly be denatured by if the broccoli was cooked. So that's okay. Just a bit of extra protein. So finally, we do have a little booklet on managing the risk of redback spiders in broccoli crops. On the back of this, it's got strategies to reduce risk. So we can see here different ways that you can reduce risk at each stage of the process. And if you'd like any more information, then please drop me an email. I'm always happy to talk about spiders being a special topic, and I hope that was of interest and of use. So thank you for watching this webinar, and drop me a line if any questions. Thank you.